Yesterday we heard a little bit about digital content, and most publishers are indeed working on digital content, and we have been working on digital content, but actually the content that most of the publishers have put on the web in the last decennium is just the PDFs. We can still, we are still in the metaphor of reading top left to bottom right, and I think that now the time has come to really make use, also as Eefke said, really make use of digital content in really in a digital way. And that is what the article of the Future Project tries to do. We try to find and use the web and find ways to really look at the different tasks that the users have, the different problems that they have, and see whether in a specific way, in a domain-specific way, we can solve those tasks, solve those contexts in a new way of presenting the article. What I will tell you this morning is a little bit the journey of the article of the Future Project. We started prototyping the article of the Future Project because we want to continue with that. In last year, we did a first prototype of the article of the future. This kept it complicated in July, and in January this year, so just 2 weeks ago, we launched the first real version on cell.com of the first ideas. I will tell a little bit why we did that, what we did, and a little bit about the user results. And after that, I will talk a little bit about semantics and contextual linking, because that was definitely a need that arose also from the article of the future. Okay. Why do we want to do this? We feel that over the last centuries, publishing became a little bit one size fits all. That was of course also directed through the paper. Everybody used the paper mechanism, and then afterwards the PDF. But now with the web in place, we have to be more domain specific. Publishing mathematics is different than publishing chemistry, is different than publishing psychology. So we really have to find ways to express the differences in the domains in the different presentations of the article. And that's where we wanted to start with. And that's what we did first with life sciences. We focused on the presentation of the article in this first prototype, so not in context and linking, etc. Just given the material that we get from the author, what can we do to improve the presentation of the article? And we did that by looking at the tasks of the reader. How does the reader want to consume the article? That has been a big focus. It was also said yesterday that we have to look at context of users, context of readers, and tasks of readers, and that's our starting point. Immediately, when we started to look in life sciences, and especially in the domain of where Cell is active, we saw that life sciences rely a lot on supplementary data, and actually, the supplementary data the amount is growing and growing, and we really wanted to better integrate that in the main type of in the main content, because it's a little bit overwhelming now at times. So that is immediately a domain specific problem that we found in life sciences. So we also worked on that. One of the side things is we didn't want to do this ourselves. We wanted to work with communities, so we did a lot of surveys, focus group interviews, user interviews. And that's how we decided that what concepts to build, to develop, and to prototype. Okay, let's look at the tasks of the users. This is one of the observations that we did, that if you look at two different tasks of the users in life sciences, first there's the task of somebody is just interested in the topic, and sometimes a user is interested in the method, and sometimes there are even other tasks like just quick skimming or just reading. And then here you see the behavior that we observed and what people look at first. So, unfortunately, they also skip areas of the article, which is a pity, and so much work done for nothing. But you see that they focus on images, they focus on images is relevant, references, and sometimes the methods. And that is the first thing that we wanted to explain or to provide a better way for in the article. And we decided to give each article a tabbed view. So there are different tabs there that really support the different behaviors the different tasks that the user is doing in the article. It's a little bit like the table of contents. You might want to say like, hey, it is the table of content, but it's not really like that. It also gives a sort of an orthogonal view on parts of the content that a certain task wants to have. For example, the images. You can just get directly to the images or directly to the methods, which is different than just in the table of contents, because that's not part of the table of contents. And it is something that we can now do in the web world. Another thing is the graphical abstract. We noticed that a lot of life sciences authors do put quite some attention and detail to the graphics that they put in there. We also noticed that a lot of users directly go to the figures to quickly get an idea of what the article is about. So we tried to combine those things and tried to evaluate and look at maybe we should, for each and every article, provide a graphical abstract, as long as that's possible, of course. The concept is already known in chemistry. There we have already graphical abstracts with structures telling about what the article is about. But in life sciences, it's less used and less well known. So we really thought, let's make it a fixed element. And also here, the reaction of the users was quite positive. You also see here a little bit how we worked with the users. When we prototyped this first, the graphical abstract was bigger. It was at the left-hand side of the screen, and you still see the prototypes if you go to the prototypes that are still available on the web. But all the users said, we love the graphical abstract, but you have to make it smaller, and you have to put it at the right side of the screen. So those little details, they're really important for users. A third thing, and which is also important for skimming and quickly getting an idea of what the article is about, is providing bulleted highlights. This was also a very popular topic amongst users. They don't want to read the abstract, they just want to see what are the research results. What is really achieved and new in this article? They don't want to read the introductory sentences of the abstract, they just want to see what's new. So we decided to highlight the research results in 3 to 5 different bullets, no more than, I think, 80 characters per bullet, and that's what authors can provide as well. Also a very popular feature with our users. This relates to what Eefke said also about multimedia. We wanted to create some extra multimedia around the article, because we thought if an author provides, for example, an audio telling a little bit about the article in a sort of more informal way, or a video abstract, that users would really like that. Well, it turns out that there's a strong division there. People either love it or they hate it. There weren't many users in the middle that said, well, it's fine. No, they either say, no, it's useless and it doesn't help me, it doesn't contribute anything to me, or they say, it is really good. And especially also here, we did something with the user feedback. Some people said, the audio is great, because then I can switch on the audio, listen to the interview or what the author has to say, and in the meantime, I am reading the article. So if you start the audio and to switch to other tabs, you still hear the audio, which was not the case in the first prototype. And that's something that's an interesting behavior, the multitasking behavior also of the user, reading the article and having the audio in the background. yesterday, we also touched upon the fact that there are much more collaborations. Many more articles have many, many authors. And it turned out also in the user behavior that the users really look at the authors and the institutes to determine the credibility of the article. And they quickly want to see what type, what authors are related to what institute. And the current way of all those little footnotes, 1, 2, A, B, until the Z of the last letter of the alphabet, if you have more than 26 authors, then it's not working anymore. So we created a mechanism that you could quickly select an institute and then immediately see the different types of authors or the different authors that were related to that institute. You see it here by highlighting of the yellow. It's something that people liked, but they didn't get really excited about this. So it's sort of a funny thing. They initially said that they really wanted to have something like this, but then we provided this and it was, well, it was definitely less relevant. Or maybe we just didn't provide the right way to do this, and they might be more excited if we would have done it in another way, but they couldn't give us another alternative either. This was the most popular topic in the article of the future prototype. Everybody loved it. It's a graphical abstract, and here you see it in a prototype form, so on the left and bigger. The graphical abstract, and it had hotspots in the graphical abstract, because sometimes in life sciences, yeah, there are processes in there, and the different processes correspond to different pieces on the graphical abstract, and you could click on it, and then you immediately jump to the particular piece in the text where that sub-process is being described. This is what our, yeah, all our users put on the first list. That's what we want to have. So what we did, well, it's technically too difficult, so we cannot do this. It was very disappointing for ourselves that this was the most wanted topic, and we really tried to do this, but it involved so much work, also extra work from the author to indicate what areas would correspond to what pieces of the text. And then in the production time, it would delay production. It would be enormous effort from the author. It would be enormously costly. So at this moment, we have not yet found a way to do this, but it's still in the back of our mind because, yeah, authors really love, or users really love this feature. You also saw in the tasks that people look at images. Currently, they quickly look at images on the PDF or on the paper because they can quickly flip through it, which is more difficult on the web. And we devised what we call then a film strip of images, and then you can quickly go over that that film strip, look at the different images. You can look at the caption of the image, but also what you cannot do in the regular paper environment, you can also click a different tab, and then you can see all the different locations where that image occurs. So there are separate sentences where the image is being mentioned. So you can immediately see the context and what's being said about the images, which is also a new, nice new feature. Apart from the images, on the left you also see that in the same way we also work with tables, Excel tables, and possibly in the future also other type of supplementary information that people can just quickly scan through it, quickly see where it does occur, where does it occur in the article. Images themselves, one of the problems with the web is that and in the paper as well, that an image is often in a fixed position, and then you go to the next page or you scroll the article and then the image is out of sight, but actually there's another reference to the image, and then people have to flip back. We have heard from users that they have two PDFs open next to each other. One where they read the article, and the other one which they just have to look at the images. And there's, of course, a behavior that indicates a problem, and we have to find a way how to solve that problem. Well, this is a solution that we took for the current cell.com implementation. We divided the window in three different parts. In the left part is the whole text, and you can scroll through the text. In the middle part, we have the image, and that you can click on an image in the text, and then that image goes there and stays there until you go to click on another image. And on the right-hand side, you see the caption, which are sometimes quite lengthy in life sciences, the long captions with talking about the A part, the B pane, the C pane of the image. The middle area is also zoomable, so you can zoom in and zoom out into the image if you want to see some more detail. So that's another thing that our users requested. Supplementary data, and especially in the area of methods and protocols, supplementary data is at this moment often provided as an extra file to the article. So what a user needs to do is read the article and then open a Word browser or a PDF browser, and then it gets it opened as a separate document, and then yeah, he or she has two different documents next to each other, the article and the supplementary data. What we heard from our users is that they want to have it integrated. And that's what we did. You cannot do that in the PDF or in the print, but on the web you can do it. The basic view is just the normal article as it is. And if you then click on the extended view, you see the supplementary data slide in those places where it really fits the regular flow of the article. Of course, it's indicated as a separate color in this case, but it's really a nice integration of supplementary data and the regular data. And that's what people, what our users really liked, that it was coming together. The last thing that you saw also is a hotspot, is looking at the references. And what we decided is, if people look at references, they probably also want to do something with it. So we tested some reference analysis on the page, that you can, for example, sort it by date of the references. You can look to just the references of a certain author or a certain journal. But we also, in the references section, we also, and you see that in the bottom box, we also wanted to provide the sentences where those references are being made, so that people really can see the reference in context. Again, something that's not possible in print or PDF, but you can do that on the web. So show me all the different locations where this reference is being made, this article is being cited. And that's also what the users wanted. So I already talked a little bit about what users wanted here. We did a survey out there, and we got about 550 respondents at the end. So those were not in user groups, but really open comments. And 80% of the users were really positive about the article of the future. 10% was negative, and 10% was neutral. The 10% negative, I will get to those later, but some of the positive comments you see here, people really liked the quick possibility to go through the article, the abstract, the highlights. The clicking and keeping it in condensed pieces. So 80% was positive. Of course, there were also some other comments and some concerns. Some people said it was too much clicking. And I think that there's always a certain amount of people that just say, I want to read the article from top left to bottom right. That's probably that 10% that didn't like this this approach. And I think that's fine. So one thing that we learned is we have to provide a button on the tabs that says, give me the full article. More work by authors, yes. It requires some more work by authors, especially if they want to have a very good graphical abstract. Graphical abstract is not obligated, but it requires some more work. Should the extra content go through peer review? Yes, obviously. So that was a concern from editors and from authors that are also reviewers. Now we have to do more work. But it's what scientific publishing is based upon. Whatever we publish has to go through peer review. So that is indeed an issue. But for us, that means we have to support the peer review process of all those different content types also in a very good way. So there's definitely some work to be done there. And of course, the obvious question, this means more work also for the author. But also for the publisher, creating more XML and more integrating all the content, should that mean that the prices increase? Well, that's definitely not the case. We say that this is ongoing development. This is just part of the scientific publishing, that we have to move this to a new format. I like the next quote. One person said the paper itself could be written in a more reader-friendly way. Well, that's something that we would like to change, but unfortunately we cannot do anything about that. There was one comment, and where are the semantics? Where's the contextual linking? I'll get to that that later. If you see the preference of what users liked, you see first there's the navigable results list. Then what I said, which we unfortunately cannot implement yet. Then you get the article highlights, those 4-5 bullets that quickly indicate how relevant or what the article is about. People really like that. On the third place, you see the figure thumbnails, the film strip, people getting a quick idea of what the article is about by looking at the different figures. And then the fourth place, you really get the graphical abstract. And those four are really, much better seen as the other ones. You see the lineup of the rest, and at the bottom you see at the eighth place the author-affiliated highlighting. Conclusions for this first prototype. Did we meet the goals of the prototype? Did we really satisfy the users here? Yes, that's definitely the case. Were there some gaps identified as well? There are still people, more people than we expected, that just wanted to read the article from top left, bottom right. Figure browsing can still be better. It's not yet optimal. There are still some suggestions that we have to look at and to implement and to see into prototype. And the semantics was one key question, is that where are the semantics? Where is the contextual linking? Well, that was not part of the prototype. The prototype was really on the article itself. How can we create a better presentation of the article? But I just want to tell two little things about semantic contextual links and semantics and using text mining. We have, as Elsevier now, two different pilots going on full text in pilots, they're already in production, using semantics to link to other databases. First on ScienceDirect you can see the NextBio. NextBio is text mining the content and then providing little boxes on the right hand side of the most relevant genes and compounds and other types of life sciences entities. And if you click on those, you really are provided a list with studies, clinical trials, news items on those entities. Another prototype that we did was with Cell. Last year, Elsevier had a contest to get ideas from the community on how could we improve scientific communication, and the winner of that context was the Reflect system, which was created by EBI and EMBL. And we also prototyped that immediately on the Cell.com platform. What it does, real time, it mines the information on the screen. It tags the different entities that it finds on genes, small compounds or proteins. And then if you click on those colored, you see pop-up boxes and with additional information and links. If you look at what people say about it, they really love what we do here. They really love the Reflect system. Again, Reflect was built by EBI, EMBL, not by us, but we put it to work here, and people really like it. They think it's useful. They think it's not intrusive. They think the right terms are being highlighted. And most people say, we want to have this default switched on. Okay. One final thing is something that I just wanted to enter here as well, is data sets is being mentioned a lot of times yesterday, and as Elsevier, we are supporting of linking to data sets that are elsewhere on the web, the primary research data, not of course the published article, and the published article as we have it should be linked and should be connected. So we are definitely supportive of that as well, and that will also be part of the future article, of the future developments. Okay, concluding, we created a prototype. It was very successful, both from the community aspect as well from what we got out of it and what we implemented. Again, it's implemented as of January on Cell. We did semantic contextual enrichment. We also found there that users really liked it, and they were forgiving in case we got some mishits, because that's what you always have if you do automatic text mining, but people liked it. And at the end, linking to data sets, we have a mechanism there, and we really should think that that's important. But of course, linking to what data sets is something that should be supported by the community. Okay, so questions will be later, I guess. Thank you very much.